Good Wednesday morning, friends, or afternoon, or whenever you might happen to join together in this time. For those that I don't know, I'm Reverend Jennifer Finley, our Momentum and Discipleship Pastor at First United Methodist Church in Kirksville. And this morning I'm not in our church building. It is a absolutely gorgeous early spring day here in Kirksville. And so I decided to come outside this morning to join you. I'm on Truman State University's campus. For those of you who aren't in this area, this is our public university in town. And it's just a beautiful day. And I just couldn't quite stand to be inside. So I thought I would join together with you from here this morning. And as I was getting ready this morning and just sort of soaking up this sun in this spot, I was watching the class change between classes as students moved between classes. And campus has a beautiful energy right now as spring weather is finally here. Students just returned from break. And I've been having conversations with our students this week about what was break like. You know, when you get a group of people back together, the first question somebody asks was, what did you do over break? And those answers have made me think about how we see God, because that's the question that we ask ourselves every week in this time. Where have we seen God this week? Where is God meeting us? And as I've heard students answer that question of for themselves about what did they do over break, I've heard some talk about big trips and wonderful trips to warmer locations. And I've heard others talk about, well, I just worked, or I was just at home. And that got me to thinking about the ways in which the things that give us joy are maybe not the things that would give other people joy. Sometimes God meets us in the ordinary moments of life that really aren't easily captured for other people, or other people might not fully understand. That happened to me this week as I shared on Facebook. Some of you may have seen this on my personal page. My moment where God met me this week was on Sunday evening, as I watched the ordinary parking lots here on campus start to fill up as students came back from break. And that's a pretty ordinary rhythm in the life of a college town. But I went for a walk that evening on campus. It was still pretty quiet. But God met me in that refreshing excitement of the possibilities of a springtime that is a little less controlled by COVID times than it has been the last couple of years. And the excitement that students have and the possibilities coming up. And it was a very, very ordinary moment of watching the parking lot start to fill up. It wouldn't have been special to anybody else, but in that moment, God met me and I found joy. Now, it wasn't a moment that was super easy to capture on social media. And that got me to thinking about one of our devotions from the Lent study that some of us are reading together. It's a book by Kate Bowler called Good Enough, but it's talking about sort of how God meets us in the ordinary moments of life. And she talks a little bit about how the things that sometimes give her joy or where God meets her and her family don't make sense to a whole lot of other people. She says, in fact, our culture has become enamored with a narrow set of criteria about what constitutes a big moment. Now, I would rephrase that to, we also have a narrow sense of what constitutes a God moment, a big moment with God. If you're an aspiring social media star in California, you'll need to be photographed in a crown of flowers by Coachella. If you're visiting the Grand Canyon, who but security can pull your spandex body in a yoga pose from teetering off the edge of a cliff? She has a great sense of humor. You might be smiling astride a camel in front of the pyramids, or throwing yourself out of a plane with a strong series of hashtags, skydiving, let go, limitless. You did it. You won Instagram or Facebook. Desire can feel like an endless hunger, but there is a feeling we get when we feel full. Contentment, and it's much harder to describe or explain. It's difficult to photograph that feeling you get looking out your window, or the rush of satisfaction when you see a smiling face. Maybe you want to cherish that perfect cup of tea or get that amazing stretch after actually sleeping through the night. Most of the big moments will not seem terribly important to anybody else. And they might actually feel awful at the time. I think that's really important. As we ask this question each week about where God is meeting us, sometimes our big moments with God don't seem like they would be important to anybody else. Someone else might not notice, or they simply might be so powerful to us that they're not on anybody else's radar. Or they're not easy to photograph. My image from Sunday night of a half-filled parking lot wasn't particularly compelling in a social media context, right? But it was God to me. And so I'm wondering, what are the ways in which God is showing up for you in those moments that aren't easy to share with others, whether it's because they aren't big and pretty, for our students or for our families? Some of you traveled over spring break and had wonderful, beautiful moments that are easily photographed, but I'd be willing to assume that some of your most special moments where God met you aren't photographed, aren't things that you could share on social media, or maybe even with your closest friends. The things that you want to cherish aren't necessarily shiny. Which is why I really have found myself compelled this week by this blessing that follows this devotion. In this book, there are blessings. And this one just is super powerful. I thought I would share it with all of us as we think about the ways in which God is meeting us. It's called A Blessing for the Life You Have. A blessing for the life you have right now, even if it's not perfect, especially if it's not perfect. Blessed are you who hold hope with an open hand, who try not to fix your gaze on time's far horizon or get drunk on what yet might be. And blessed are you who avoid walking too far down memory lane, getting stuck wondering if that was as good as it gets, if you're piqued or feeling resentful about all that has disappointed before. Blessed are you who know that sometimes you need to stay right here, right here, at least for a moment. Blessed are you who look wide-eyed, maybe timidly, at the present moment, gazing at those things that are gently, actually within your fingertips. Blessed are you amid the ordinary details that define what life is for you right now. And as you see them, greet them, each one. As you smile and call them by name, everyday joys, small pleasures, birds chirping, cat cuddles, a cold glass of water, a child calling your name, the breeze on your cheeks or the sun on your face, the ocean rhythm, or the perfect pillow, or the good night's sleep, the kindness of a friend, loves that are and were and ever will be. May they seem even lovelier, even more delicious, because they become gifts offered anew. May gratitude fill you, reaching all the spaces within you that disappointment left behind and fear has gripped. May something rise in your heart that feels like a strange new kind of contentment. Because this isn't what you had planned, but it surprises you that even here it can be good, satisfying in a way that you know you can come back to. A place that can sustain you through whatever may come. Blessed are you, finding that life is good because it is enough. Friends, that one caught me, that last line, for myself, because as I mused on Sunday evening here on this campus, I was remembering what I did 2 years ago with our students. Well, 3 years ago. And I was remembering the time 2 years ago when everything changed and students didn't come back from break. And as we move into new normals and new rhythms, and there's some new excitement, and my temptation is to do all the things we used to do, or to be sad that we can't do them. And so as I'm thinking about my student friends, my faculty friends, but also all of us as we're in this season of Lent, these words, because this isn't what you had planned, the last 2 years and where we find ourselves now, whatever that life has brought, isn't probably what we had planned. If you had said to me 3 years ago, tell me the journey you're going to be on for these next 3 years, I couldn't have predicted any of it. Because this isn't what you had planned, but it surprises you that even here it can be so good. Friends, even here it can be so good. In a way that we can come back to. A place that can sustain us through whatever may come. Because it is enough. Now, it's easy to hear those words of blessing. It's much harder to practice them. And one thing I love about this devotion is it gives us something practical, a practical step to take in addition to a blessing. And this one says, we can be convinced that our happier life, our better self, is just out there someplace, but maybe it's not as out of reach as we thought. And it invites us to look around, to hold out your hand, and then hold it to your chest, and to feel a steady pulse, or perhaps it's on your wrist, wherever you can feel that heartbeat. What feels like contentment for you, right here, right now? Whatever that is, big or small. Perhaps it's sitting under the stained glass window at a church building, or sitting on a porch, or for me, sitting here in the sun. Or perhaps it's in a warm cup of tea or coffee. Whatever it is, perhaps in those moments where we don't know how to share that with others, we simply put our hands in our chest, feel our heart beating, take a deep breath, and say a moment of prayer of gratitude to God for that moment. And then our days move on. So friends, it's my prayer practice for this week, and my invitation to you is to take that, and wherever God is meeting you, to allow that to be enough for today. And I hope wherever you are that you may have the opportunity to enjoy some beautiful sunshine. Go in peace, my friends. Amen.